subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
The issue topmost on our mind these days is coronavirus. So what we are doing is now, until this situation lasts, as and when possible and as and when we have something new to tell you or additional to tell you, we will give you an additional dose of Cut the Clutter, if I may use that expression. I would have liked to call it Cut the Corona Clutter, but let's stick with one hashtag. This will continue as Cut the Clutter, but on some days I'll give you two Cut the Clutters, one on another issue and one an update on Corona. So this is the first Cut the Corona Clutter. What we will do here is try to sift scientific, genuine developments which are confirmed or which come from credible sources and take them out of all the stuff that you get on WhatsApp, on Twitter, on hearsay, on family groups. There is far too much of muck flowing around. And there I have my young colleagues who also look at things very carefully. In this case, Ayush Patnaik has done it. I also watch scientific news very carefully. It has nothing to do with the fact that I had a science degree because that was some time back. Only, or maybe just a short while back in 1975. So don't blame that degree on any knowledge. I get this knowledge from published material. So today we'll tell you about some developments. One, a little worrying. Some, reassuring. All from the world of science, medicine, research. So first one is a study by Imperial College London. Now, if you heard Donald Trump's press conference last night, Donald Trump and his coronavirus stream, I can tell you one of the best things to watch these days is every evening the US White House coronavirus press briefing. Donald Trump comes himself, his key team members come in, and they answer all questions freely for a long time. In fact, last night, our time, press meeting at White House went on for 90 minutes. Where they all answered questions. And they were questions about an Imperial College study. And Trump was asked, have you seen the Imperial College study? And do you believe, and does your team believe, that those estimates are right? He said, the people standing behind me are the best team in the world. They are in touch with everybody, including Imperial College. Anybody who's doing any research on corona anywhere in the world is in touch with his team. And so he pointed to the same scientist that we spoke about yesterday, Dr. Deborah Brix, Anthony Fauci, his Surgeon General, Admiral, and all the others, including his Vice President. Now, what is this Imperial College study? That study is that if you don't interfere with the virus or the spread of the virus, if you don't intervene to slow the spread of the virus, or what is called flattening the curve, then in America, 70 to 80% people will eventually, in fact, more likely 80% will get infected by the virus. Now, 80% Americans will get infected, of which 0.9% will die. Now, 0.9% of American population is a lot of people. That is almost 2.2 million people. Because the other way of looking at this is that if you apply this formula, that is what Imperial College has done, and these things are done all through modeling. There are formula, there are formulae, there are systems, and there are techniques in statistics and epidemiology which are used to make these projections. So this shows, I mean, one way is to say 0.9% of 80% will die. But the other way of looking at this is that 4 to 8% of all Americans above 70 years of age will die. That is 2.2 million people. Then the same study looks at the next prospect, that if this peak comes too soon, because you are not flattening the curve, that too many of these older people will come up with the need for ventilators. The need for ventilators then will be 30 times the number of ventilators available in America. It's not going to be available to all. In any case, of the people who go on ventilator, 50% will die. Those who don't go on ventilator, 100% will die. So once your ventilator capacity is overwhelmed, your fatalities will go up. So 4.4 million will die. Then he goes on to say, you have to understand what is 4.4 million people? 4.4 million people is more than any Americans, any number of Americans that have died in anything. Second World War, the Civil War, anything. It's a lot of people. It's 2/3 of the number of people who died in the Holocaust. It's a lot of people. And if you then extrapolate it to global population, US is 4.4% of the world's population. If you look at the entire world's population, then 9 crore people will die if this spreads like that. And that is presuming that rates of death are not higher elsewhere. And 9 crore means 15 times the Holocaust. 15 times the Holocaust. Or much more, 1.5 times World War II. All deaths in World War II. Is the world in 2020, 21, 22 ready to see that kind of deaths? Now, how do you slow it down and how do you handle it? So, once again, the study projects that if you follow methods that are suppressive, which means, which are mitigatory, which means you tell people to stay at home, not go out too much. If somebody is sick, quarantine that person or treat that person, then you will reduce it and you might get half as many deaths. But that also is a lot of deaths. So at the third level, don't lose all hope. At the third level, the study says, if you suppress it, suppress means if in one family, one person comes up with a virus, you quarantine the entire family. You keep offices shut, schools shut, public places shut, and keep contact, just as the Italians and the Spaniards and the French have done right now. If you do that very early on, then you can reduce it to maybe thousands in a country like America. Then there is a concern that will this virus go away, will it come back, but those things will come later. So apparently, nobody is acknowledging it, apparently we can see or we can guess that the reason both Britain and America have raised their alert levels and concern levels, and both Boris Johnson and Trump have stopped making fun of coronavirus, which is something that we noted yesterday in Cut the Clutter. This might be the reason this has happened. This has raised concern levels, and all of us need to understand the science. In fact, on the screen, you will see the first page of the excerpt of this study. You can go to the Imperial College website, read the entire study. It's called Impact of Non-Pharmaceutical Intervention, or NPIs, to Reduce COVID-19 Mortality and Healthcare Demand. Because mortality is linked to pressures on healthcare demand. If healthcare collapses under a sudden peak in demand, then many more deaths will take place. But if you can stagger it, then that healthcare system will be able to handle it better. So that is pure science. There is statistics in it, and you can dispute it, but this is science. So at least it gives you a scientific basis to take an argument forward. In essence, I will not disagree with it. I will, as I said, err on the optimistic side. I will not disagree with this. I will prepare for the worst. So that is one. Now you look at a couple of more things which have come up, which are on the positive side and which may be reassuring. So first of all, there is this bunch of studies that Bloomberg reported yesterday. Now these are studies that Bloomberg's very good reporter who covers science, medicine, etc., David Fickling reported. And when he reports something, I take it seriously. So he said that there is a significant correlation between weather conditions and the spread of the virus. And three different studies have come in. One from Europe by researchers from Portugal, Spain, and Finland, and two from China. And all three show that there is a correlation of weather, of temperatures, and humidity with the spread of the virus. What that means is that the virus doesn't spread that much in extremely hot and extremely cold conditions. That might be the reason it's not so widespread in Russia as yet, or in the polar regions as yet. So what these studies tell you is that with each degree rise in temperature, right now these are non-peer-reviewed studies, so keep that caution in your mind. But these have now been put up on fairly credible websites. So besides the study from Portugal, Spain, and Finland, there is a study by four Beijing-based researchers, which has been loaded on this scientific website, which has looked at the the record of the spread of coronavirus in 100 Chinese cities. And this study says that something called RO, which is the rate of spread of coronavirus, is affected by temperature. So far, it's been 2.2 in China, which is very high. How do you bring it down? To bring it down, they say that with every degree rise in temperature, every degree Celsius rise in temperature, the RO, this index or rate of spread, comes down by 0.0383. It's very little. In fact, three times this much will be 0.1, but it's significant. So each degree rise brings it down by this much. Further, they say each percentage point rise in humidity brings it down by 0.0224%. And that then reflects also in the pattern that you see globally. Because if you look around the equator in the world, then countries that are closer to the equator have seen less of the viral spread. Countries in the northern hemisphere, in fact, you must have been seeing this in social media, also international media, that people draw a line from Wuhan, which goes something like about 2,000 kilometers to the north of India, 1,500 to 2,000 kilometers to the north of Delhi. And most of the cases around the world are located along that line. Now, is there a weather temperature connection to that line? Is that line and that rate of spread or pattern of spread telling us something about the link of coronavirus and weather or temperature? But this study seems to indicate that there is something like that. And as you come south, as you come towards the equator, so look at countries like Indonesia, Philippines, Thailand. They have much more contact with China than countries of Europe. They have much more travel between them and China. So they've got some cases, but very few cases in comparison. In fact, if you see the example, see one very interesting comparison, say Thailand, Indonesia, Philippines on one side, and put Estonia, Slovenia, and Iceland on the other. This is what the study says. Those countries have 1% of the population of some of these countries. In fact, most of these countries, Thailand, Indonesia, Philippines, will have 100 times more population than Estonia, Slovenia, Iceland, very small populations. But they have more cases of COVID-19 than these countries. And even if you ascribe that to lesser testing in these countries, in Indonesia, Philippines, Thailand, also, although these countries have very good health systems, particularly Thailand and the Philippines. But even then you can see that there is perhaps a link with location, with temperature. So that is one optimistic note that you can look at. Iran, you might say that, if this is true, then why does Iran have so many cases? So look at the Middle East. If you look at the map for the Middle East, you will see that Iran stands out in the Middle East as a country on a high plateau, closer to the north, and its weather pattern, particularly in winter, is much more like Europe's weather pattern. So that's the reason, possibly, that Iran has seen a lot more of the viral spread. But these are right now all non-peer-reviewed studies. There are a couple more things. There's a drug called favipiravir. Now, I don't exactly know what is an antiretroviral and what is a drug which works against RNA viruses. So this is a drug that works against RNA viruses. This drug was cleared by the Japanese authorities for use in influenza cases in 2014. Chinese researchers in their first studies have found that this is effective in treating patients of COVID-19. So there is one study from the Third People's Hospital in Shenzhen. Shenzhen is one of China's first special economic zones close to Hong Kong. That study has shown between one control group and one group given this drug that people given this drug recovered and became negative with the virus much earlier than the other group. Another study, which is a bigger study, it's a multi-centered randomized trial. Randomized trial is when there's a control group, there's another group, but control group doesn't know Nobody knows who's getting the real medicine, but control group gets no medicine, a placebo. The other ones get the medicine. Then you compare the results. That has also shown, and this is at Zhongnan Hospital, Wuhan University, which is the epicenter of the virus. That has also shown that this drug works. So the Chinese put these details out. In fact, this was a statement made by Chang Jinmin. My pronunciation of Chinese names and words may not be, is unlikely to be perfect, but you will see the names on the screen. Chang Jinmin, who's director of Chinese Ministry of Science and Technology, who has said, essentially by way of advice, that this drug is useful, so work on it. Then there is chloroquine, the old chloroquine, which all of us were given when we got malaria. In fact, in many parts of India, if you ask the armed forces, paramilitary forces, people who suffer, who serve in northeast or in wetter areas or in Chhattisgarh, they would sometimes tell you Saturday is a dry day or Friday is a dry day. What that means is that's when they take their chloroquine. So that chloroquine is a prophylactic against malaria and dry day, because alcohol is contraindicated when you have anti-malarial drugs. Now that anti-malarial drug has been found to have some effect. Elon Musk of Tesla fame shared a research paper that's come out on this, but also this is something that's being used by doctors everywhere, including doctors at Sawai Man Singh Medical College in Jaipur, who claim to have successfully treated 4 patients using a cocktail of drugs, which includes chloroquine. In fact, the brand they've used is Lariago. Plus, they say they've used some well-known anti-HIV antiretrovirals, in that case lopinavir plus ritonavir, means nothing to me, but these are antiretrovirals which have been used for a long time to suppress infection in HIV patients. So these things have worked. Chloroquine is being used. Once again, it's not yet a cure. And a third drug, which is remdesivir, again a paper has appeared, and you will see the name on the screen, which is also found to be of some effect and definitely no adverse effects right now. So these are the big changes, big developments that we've seen by this time. So these are the scientific updates so far. Please keep watching Cut the Clutter and also Cut the Corona Clutter. On some days, as I said, we'll do 2 of these and send us your views. We'll get back to you. And remember, if you're not subscribing already to our channel, please do so. Tell your friends, family, neighbors, everybody, particularly if they're going to be spending more time at home. We promise, one, not to bore you, and second, not to give you any folk news or fake news. We'll try and give you what we believe to be is the most authentic information, and we'll be even more careful with a sensitive issue like coronavirus.